Going live, and I think that means that with a little bit of luck, we should be streaming publicly over YouTube and Google Hangouts on air today. I must always check. February 21. I know for heaven's sake it's Friday. That's for sure. And in my tone, luckily, I'm pretty much done when we're done with the show. So it's pretty good timing for me. And as usual, this is Be Smart on Air interview. And this time, I'm not going to the other side of the pond for a change, which is okay, really. We are in Europe, and I have with me Georg Holzmann. Georg, did I get your name roughly right?
Hello, Niilo. Yes, that's correct.
Hello, Österreich. Is that sound correct?
Hello. Hello, Sweden.
Man, I'm slipping here. Let's try to stick to English. Like I said earlier, my German is not that good any longer. I love speaking German, but I get frustrated because I get stuck these days. It's been many years, you know. I think we'll be getting into audio processing and kind of technical stuff quite a bit later on, and warning here, Georg, I'm not an engineer, so you must go easy on me, okay?
That's great. Yes, you have to. So you have to ask everything you don't understand.
I sure will. Let's talk a little bit about you to start with. What's your background? Apparently, you are in a highly technological field since your company, if I got it right, Auphonic, is that correct?
Yeah, Auphonic.
Auphonic is all about signal processing audio. But what is your background? How did you get into this, and where did you go to school? I am always interested in that since I'm a teacher, you know?
Yeah, that's already long ago.
you shouldn't say that. You know, I told you earlier, I'm more than half a century old, so it isn't long ago for you.
Yes, I went to school here in Austria, and so actually I grew up at the border to Slovenia, so in the south of Austria, and now I'm here in Graz. That's also a city next to the border to Slovenia, and yeah, I went to university here, and there is an interesting study here which is called audio engineering. Okay. And yeah, there you learn different things about signal processing and also about music and computer music and more art stuff. So it's quite interesting because it's very technical and also very artistic and music related. And yeah, this was my start, and then I went more into the direction of computer science and did a lot of machine learning. And I was in Berlin at the university there. And
okay, I know Berlin fairly well.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, not Graz.
Yeah, Berlin is a little bit bigger than Graz.
I guess so, yeah.
And yeah, then I did a little bit of web development and all this stuff with browsers and internet. And I was listening to lots of podcasts and speaking to some popular German podcasters, which always told me that everything is so complicated. You have to be an audio engineer to process everything, and you need to get all the correct audio formats and the metadata handling, and everything is complicated. And so they started in small scripts which try to automate this workflow to create podcasts. And it also started with lecture recordings, because this is a little bit similar. So here at the university in Graz, they also do lots of recordings, and you have to process them. And yeah, and it started getting bigger and bigger. And
were you into podcasting yourself, or people you knew?
No, I'm no podcaster yet.
Okay.
I'm
a podcaster either. I'm just talking to interesting people like you, you know.
Yes, I only give interviews in other podcasts.
Very good.
No, but I was especially speaking with some popular podcasters from Germany, and yeah, they had lots of ideas what could be done, but nobody did it, and so we started to do it.
All right. How would you, by the way, this is kind of interesting, talking about podcasts. I've been listening to another Hangout on Air live internet show called Podcasters Roundtable. They are like pro podcasters chatting there. I think it's something like once a month or whatever. And one of the episodes, they were talking about, well, of course, podcasting. What is it actually? And it was kind of interesting since it wasn't very actually clear cut and obvious what it was. So they had like several definitions in a way themselves, even though those guys are pros. What do you what's your view on this? What is a podcast actually?
Yeah, you know, I don't care about definitions, so for me it's everything I can listen to.
All right, so this is interesting. I don't care about definitions either, but sometimes things get messed up if people talk about podcasts and you think they are talking about something else. So
yeah, no, the definition is quite complex actually, because they always want to make a difference between radio and podcast, but end it's maybe the same.
But isn't the fact that podcasts most often are not live actually, but you can subscribe to them.
Yeah, actually the trend is maybe that podcasts are live and also not live, so some people
lines are blurring, huh?
Like here, you know, some people can listen to us live maybe, and some others just look through the recording.
Yeah, but I was about to say they can't subscribe to the show actually, but I guess they can actually on YouTube. They can. So I don't know either.
Yeah.
Sorry, I just got in on a sidetrack here a little bit.
Yeah, but for me also the non-live component is quite interesting, because you can just put it on your phone and hello.
Hey, Bjorn is looking. Shall we give him a quick time slot here, like 5 seconds or so, to say hello and tell the world who he is. Who are you, Bjorn? What are you doing here?
Oh man, you're not gonna even let me check my audio first.
Nope. You are the pro. You and Georg here. You are the pros. You should have everything all set, you know. So,
well, the problem is I'm at home. Hi everybody. I'm Bjorn Berendt from the Ed Listen podcast. I'm actually at home and not in front of my regular equipment. And I just plugged in my Audio Technica. Actually, it's the AT. This is the 2005. It's the black one.
I don't care what it's called.
Oh, come on. Right into my Chromebook. So it worked. So I'm happy.
Well, anyway, you sound good. Who are you? What do you do?
Who am I?
Yeah. Oh, okay. What kind of a guy are you?
I'm a crazy guy that likes to have my own podcast and talk a lot.
Good enough.
I'm an IT coordinator for a school over in Vermont. And a lot of great things happening there, and let's see. Yeah, I just jumped on here, so.
And you are a gearhead, obviously.
Oh yeah, I am a gearhead. The problem is I'm at home and not in front of my big gear.
So it's a good thing you could come in here, since I was telling Georg here earlier that obviously I don't know anything what he's talking about when things get technical, so you can like translate everything.
Nah.
It's good to have you here, Bjorn. Yeah, very well.
Now, and Georg, thank you very much for audio. I'm forgetting the name.
Auphonic.
Georg, is that correct?
Auphonic. I always have to find it, but yeah, I love it. I've been using it for the past two episodes of my podcast. So
actually, we should spell it. So since you don't have a lower thirds, Georg, Auphonic. How does it spell? Like A-U-P-H. And then
O-N-I-C.
O-N-I-C. Odd
Auphonic.
I must check that. So oh, man. Auphonic. A-U-P-H-O.
Yeah. I know it's a complicated word, but I had no better idea.
The URL was open. That's the best part.
It's a good name. It rolls just fine off of my tongue, at least, when I practice a little bit. We were talking about podcasts, actually. Where were we? We tried to define podcasts, and then we didn't get anywhere, I think. but you said, Georg, that you haven't been podcasting yourself, but you got interested in the way people work with audio. Is that correct?
This is correct, yes.
And so how did you guys move on from did you have some friends already with you, we're talking to some of your friends about this, doing something about making it easier to process audio.
Yeah, actually, it started because I was doing some research in this direction at the at the university in Berlin, and I did a lot of machine learning where we tried to classify specific parts of the audio. And yeah, afterwards I did this web development jobs. And so we try to combine everything. So trying to automate all the audio processing parts. So first you have to know somehow what's in the audio. So you have to classify a specific parts and then make all the signal processing algorithms and try to automate them out of the things you learn from the audio before. And here it started small and went and got bigger and bigger.
So how long time ago was it when you got Auphonic started? You have a company behind the web page called Auphonic, is that correct?
Yes, the company, it's not called Auphonic, it's just my name.
All right, yeah.
But this is just because of legal reasons.
Yeah, I understand.
Yeah, I started with it 2010, I think, in October 2010 or something like this. And we went online in March 2012, so 1.5, it's nearly 2 years ago.
All right.
And here, then I also got some fundings here in Austria, and other people joined the project. And yeah, now the fundings are over.
All right. How are you going to survive here?
Yes, we have to. So the concept is, of course, that we will introduce a freemium model so that users which do a lot of processing have to pay for it, and to a specific point you can use it for free. So that's
all
the
right.
plan.
Mm-hmm. Are you specifically targeting podcasters, or are you thinking about that other professionals might have use for this service as well?
Yeah, of course, podcasters are only one group which could be interested. So, of course, the whole lecture recording and everything is of course, optimal for our algorithms because it's built for that. And it's also used here at the universities to process the audio and to automate everything. And, of course, also the broadcasting radio world, because there are new loudness standards and we do all this automatically. They have to confirm to these standards now, at least in Europe and in the US. And yeah, everything which is done with audio, which has a focus on spoken word, sorry. So everything which is radio-like or spoken, this is the target for our service.
Now, are you planning on getting into media hosting at all? I mean, I know I can auto-upload to Libsyn, but I'll tell you right now, I'd be more than happy to drop my Libsyn account if you did media hosting and send the money your way.
Yes,
not that I don't think Libsyn's bad. I just love what you're doing.
Yeah, we thought about this as well, and actually we wanted to do it, but it's just too much work. So we have to focus on our things. We are not that big that we can do everything. But there is an interesting new hosting platform which also integrates Auphonic automatically, so you don't have to have an Auphonic account. It's called bodyg.com, and they do actually everything. So they are quite interesting.
How do you spell that?
I posted it into the chat, so it's bodyg. Like bod, bodyg.
For once, I'll try to do some. Try to see if there will be some show notes afterwards, so everyone can find your website and these addresses we mentioned here. Otherwise, it would be really a pity. Yeah, I see it there.
Podigy. Now, is Podigy a competitor to you?
No, but actually, they use our service. But it's we offer an API, so everyone can integrate us in other services, and they are just using us, and they build the whole the audio web layer where we have chapters automatically and can jump to specific time points and share links and time points and everything, and they host the whole audio, and there you can also make, of course, a blog page with show notes for your episodes.
Huh. So it's like your service is kind of built in Podigy.
Exactly, yeah.
Okay, cool.
Ah, I like that model, because that means, even if we're going to get who's the guy on Lipson? Is that Rob?
Yeah,
I think post there?
This is Rob Varg, yeah.
Yeah, we got to get him to, sublease you for, like I said, I'd pay a little bit extra to get the audio processing.
This would be great,
one of their services.
If Lipson would integrate us, so it's perfectly possible technically. So it's just a matter of implementing it.
Mm-hmm. Oh, cool. Well, we got to get Rob on that one.
Rob, I tried a couple of files talking about what you can do with crappy recordings. if you like, I'm a teacher, like I said, and I don't have any time, not expertise either, to polish the recordings. I got to do, the quick and dirty stuff. And I had half a dozen more than something like 10, 20, I guess, all in all, files, like something like half an hour recordings, whatever. And I used your website, Georg, and upload the stuff and hit the button. And, I took the works, everything, all the processing you could do, since you can do quite a lot of stuff there. And, oh boy, it is pretty darn amazing, I must say that. Those recordings were almost useless before I ran them through your service. And afterwards, it was fine. I could use them all right. You could hear everyone speaking there, even though I was really close to the, I was using my smartphone, really close to it, and the students, they're way back there. So, wow, I'm impressed.
Now, how about those quick little pops? Do you have an algorithm to stop those?
Maybe should I explain what we are actually doing?
With, please. Yeah, that's a good idea.
Just a broad overview. So,
yeah.
Basically, what we are doing is if you upload an audio file, then we will first, of course, analyze it, what's in there. So there are different. If you have a recording, like, let's say, a podcast, there are three speakers, like here now, we have three people. And let's say there are also some music parts. And first we analyze this audio and see, okay, here is the music part, and here is this speaker and this speaker and so on. And then we try to adjust the levels of these speakers and the music parts. And there you have to distinguish between the different parts, because, for example, with music you have to do this whole loudness processing completely different than with speech, for example, because music has some inner dynamics, so there are loud parts and soft parts, and you don't want to destroy all this dynamic of the music. And with speakers, you want to make it sound more equally loud, so you can much more aggressive adjust the volumes. But you also have to be cautious, because, for example, there are also pauses where there is just some noise, or if you have lecture recordings, there is I don't know. Then maybe the teacher is fighting on somewhere, so there are just some stupid noises, and you don't have to amplify them. So you always have to classify what's in there, and only if it's relevant, then you amplify it. So this is the loudness processing we are doing. Then there is also some filtering. So for example, if we are speaking, we don't need all the low frequencies, which are below the frequency of our voice, so you can remove everything of this. And this is most of the time they are very annoying. So this is some rumbling and power line hums or everything like that. And with music, you have to do it a little bit different, because there are bass instruments which are much lower, and you can just remove all the low frequencies because it would sound not good.
Yeah.
And then are also some audio restoration algorithms like noise reduction and hum reduction. So this works like this. So noise reduction. In noise reduction, you analyze the audio again, and you want to have a sample of the noise, so how the noise is sounding. So actually, that's the background sound if you just have a noise. And then you try to subtract this noise from the whole signal, so the clean signal stays. So therefore, you have to find this noise sample first. So you search through the audio and look in very quiet parts and try to extract very quiet parts where there are just noise samples. And afterwards, you can use these samples to make the noise reduction. And there you also have to detect where this quiet part changes, because, for example, we make an interview here in this room, and then we go outside, and in the outside there is a completely different background noise. So you also have to classify where these backgrounds are changing, and also make the noise reduction just in these segments where they're not changing. And yeah, hum reduction is also an algorithm which is online already, which is basically similar as noise reduction, but often you have a power line hums in your recordings. So this is do you know what I mean with power line hums? If you plug in your laptop somewhere and then you have this
from the mains somehow.
These hums, yes, yeah. Exactly. Mm-hmm. And this is very, very, very difficult to remove.
Mm-hmm.
And this works similar like noise reduction. You have to classify which hum is there or if there is anything, and then you remove all these hum frequencies from the audio.
So Niilo, just to get things straight, I understood everything he said, and I spent several hours trying to get that after my recording out manually. And that's why you keep coming back and says, your audio sounds good. Well, yeah, well, everything he just said, I've had to do manually without the algorithms.
Yeah, and I'm telling you, that's just, you know, crazy talk for me, even trying to do anything like that. Because number one, I would not have the time, and number two, I couldn't possibly cope with it. So, I mean, no way. And I think that applies to most people in education. You, Bjorn, I don't know where you find that time. You are in education in a way yourself, more or less. How the heck, when do you do it? Nighttime or what? When your kids are sleeping, you know? You're a dad too, heaven's sake.
Yeah, I get the dad thing. That's why I do my podcast on Friday right after school. I found my little time, niche time, and the audio processing is getting harder, but I do like it.
But this stuff you were talking about, Georg, I mean, everything is post, isn't it? It's post processing. So it's nothing of this is happening or can be happening the way you guys work during the recording live. Like right now, there are algorithms at work, I think, with the audio in Google Hangouts. But that's not the way you guys do it. Is that correct?
Yes, that's correct. So, of course, you can do this also live. But if you do it afterwards, you can, of course, do it much better, because you can analyze everything and you see the whole history of the audio, and so you can do it in a better quality.
Yeah, absolutely.
Mm-hmm. This is, of course, just the start of our service, so there will many other algorithms follow, especially for, I'm saying it now already quite long, but we're actually developing some new multi-channel algorithms. So at the moment, it works like you upload your master file, your stereo file or mono file or whatever, And in a new version, there will also be a multi-channel mode where you can just upload your individual tracks. So for example, if we record now, we have three tracks because we have three speakers. So in theory, we can process every track separately and then mix it together afterwards. So we can
Jeez.
It would be even better. And one more thing. Then you can also do much better metadata automatically from the audio tracks. So for example, you can extract all this nice metadata when someone is speaking and skip to the next speaker or make statistics how many times or how many percentage one speaker is speaking and all these kind of things.
You are going to just change. You're going to bring podcasting right back up front. Because that is just some of the things that we do manually in the background.
Yeah. And,
you know, every podcaster needs to be doing this stuff just because good audio quality actually is important. And I know there's a couple really great podcasts that have a lot of great content that I physically can't listen to just because
right.
The audio is bad.
We've been talking about that, Bjorn, you and me, chatting about that earlier, and I have also mentioned the same thing, that there are pretty neat. I listen to quite a few podcasts. That's really changed. It's been a game changer to me. That's what I do with my smartphone. Pretty much that's the thing I do with it. Okay, something else too, but no phone calls basically. But every day I listen to quite a bit of talk shows and stuff. Rarely music when I'm on the run, but when I'm commuting or when I'm in a plane or whatever, most often I'm listen to podcasts, some of that stuff, like Bjorn said, there's so much great content, even in education only, and that's of course our main focus here. But some of those things, there's so much noise in the background and weird pops and cracks and whatnot. I mean, of course, I can. There might be 10 students, you know, charging in here, and we're doing this thing live, so it's part of the game in a way. But listening, especially listening to a podcast where people should have had the chance to do something about it afterwards, and if it's really crappy, I can't listen to it either, you know, and it's a shame.
Yeah, and another important thing, I think, beside audio quality, is also the metadata you attach to the audio files, because podcasts are often very long, and then you have this 1 or 2 hour files of interviews, and you just have this blob of data and don't know what to do with it 2 months later. So actually, we are in very close collaboration with another project, which is called BotLove. The link is in the chat, botlove.org. That's also a project from a very popular German podcaster who tries to improve the whole podcasting infrastructure. And this is they built a very nice web layer, for example, where you have all the one important step are chapter marks for them. So they have chapters and you see them in the web layer and you can click on the specific chapter and see what's going on there. So a small description. And this is of course especially important if you want to listen to this recording a few months later, because you can just see here it is. And there are also already search engines which shirt can search through the chapters. And then if you search it, you can directly link to the audio and also the exact time.
That's excellent. That's a game changer for sure.
You can immediately switch to the correct location into the recording. Mm-hmm. And yeah, I think this is very important. And also what I was talking before, the automatic transcription when someone is speaking, or of course, the perfect thing would be really good automatic speech transcription.
Yeah.
But I think this will still take some time.
Yeah, I don't think anybody's gotten that one right. I've seen some manual, you know, people that are listening and typing. But now, Rob, I want to go.
come on.
I'm looking at Rob Walsh's thing. You know, I was plugging him for Libsyn to try and see if get him to, you know, subcontract with Actually, how do you say your name again?
Auphonic.
Auphonic. No, the George. It's not George.
Georg.
I want to say
Georg.
Georg.
It's German, like yours, Bjorn. You should fix this, for heaven's sake.
Niilo, you say my name better than I do. Okay.
Okay. Bjorn, I have like... and Bjorn and Georg.
Exactly.
Yeah. Well, I say Bjorn, which just does not sound nice. Georg. Okay. Going back to bringing in the three different speakers and sync, will that actually synchronize the audio too? Or am I going to have to manually do that? Or is that something? Because that's another big thing that it would be nice.
Not in the first version, maybe later. So let's see.
I am so excited about that one because I like to record everybody separately and process them separately.
Now you're talking about when you have like guests in your studio, Bjorn, right?
Yeah, and a lot of times, like when you're interviewing somebody, if you're really doing it, you know, with a little bit extra setup, you'll have people in different rooms. Or a lot of podcasters will record a double ender where each one gets recorded. And this sounds like a perfect platform where, you know, if I was recording this on my end, Niilo, you were recording the audio separately. Georg, we can get him to record it because he actually understands to do that. Or for me, you could record yours and I can record his separately.
There was this talking about it. Talking about Hangouts again, there was this app, you mentioned that, Bjorn, and I was talking to, or chatting with, Ray Ortega, right? One of those, yep. I mentioned that to you, Georg, he's one of those pro podcasters, he's actually the guy, the host for the Podcasters Roundtable, huh? And he was trying this Hangout app that made it possible for each and every participant in a Hangout, in the panel, so to speak, to record his or her own audio and then somehow like get the whole thing together in the end. But that just didn't work for a longer broadcast. It was just something like 10 minutes or whatever.
Yeah,
well, I'm looking at, I could upload to Audiophonic. Niilo, you could upload to Audiophonic, and I'm assuming we could merge those two together. You know, that saves trying to put them up to, you know, Dropbox to get them to me, for me to do it, a processing. There's some huge advantages in being able to easily, you know, manipulate these things. And Georg, if you're, I don't know if the desktop app, which I saw you just produced, if that could record audio separately, you know, if I could record, you know, just my end on, you know, if I could turn on Audiophonic, turn on the Hangout and have it record, have Niilo turn on Audiophonic and the Hangout and have it record, and then it all merges together. I mean, I'm just seeing possibilities, just endless possibilities of, you know, finally higher quality audio in
these
this medium.
These are all our ideas we already planned, but of course, it's a lot of work.
Yeah.
It is.
You guys should be talking to Google too, you know, like this Hangouts thing. I don't know. There might be common denominators here somehow, you know. They are doing audio processing all the time with the Hangouts. Of course, it's live, but I guess the same main ideas apply anyway, huh?
Well, there's always an app, you know, to add something else to the list, but. No, but the cool thing about this is I'm getting excited about it. And not only for my own podcast, but I now can take all those younger, you know, the younger kids and teachers who really don't have the best equipment, who don't have the best, you know, things, and actually create the podcast around that. So and get a little bit better audio than that open room type of a deal. So... I'm excited. I'm already trying to see how we're going to be using it in the classroom.
Yeah, well, I've already been using it in a classroom. Well, I've using it in a way, yeah. Since those recordings, my students were actually, it's kind of a test where they are supposed to discuss certain topics, and for once I recorded. I told them I recorded this thing just for myself, you know, and they were fine with that. And of course, I knew that the recordings will be pretty crappy, since I just have my phone there on the table and they are spread out in the room. And oh man, I mean, it really, really did some amazing things after the Auphonic run.
I wonder if is there a way that I can pull from YouTube, run it through Auphonic?
Yeah, it's technically it's possible, but it's forbidden by YouTube, so you're not allowed to do this.
Yeah.
How about if you were the owner of the audio?
Exactly, like you have your YouTube channel, like BSoA YouTube channel. You know, it's my stuff.
Mm, okay, I have to check this. Maybe that's possible. Yeah, I don't know.
Like when this stuff I'm doing, you know, having the video. Of course, it's. I feel that when you're doing this thing live with other people, that's tons of fun. But I don't think really that many people want to watch. I never watch these hangouts, basically. I always listen to them. I always listen to them because I don't have time to watch them. But I have time when I'm commuting or sitting in a plane or whatnot. And when I'm done with the show, I always have to extract the audio. And it's not a big deal, but it takes a bit of time. And, well, you know, you got to go through the motions. And I was thinking, like I guess we chatted about this, Bjorn, earlier, that, man, if I could somehow do this thing, that my shows from my YouTube shows, my content, would be automatically, you know, like, run through the Auphonic magic here, and I'd get the better version of the show, you know, without any manual stuff there. That would be
yeah, that's
awesome. I try to avoid that word, but it would be awesome.
Yeah, that's actually a good idea. I just noted it. So
yeah, I mean,
but there's a big problem.
I think it should be possible if you were the owner of the channel that you can grab your content. Why not?
No, I'm looking at it because we have a student who does the weather every single day. Really, really good guy. We actually hooked him up with a local TV station, so he's going to be doing TV. Facebook/Vermont Weather. Awesome student, personal project. But his hiccup is that they need better audio from him. And he's doing that. I mean, he's doing green screen from his iPhone and everything else, but the audio just isn't there. And it would be really nice if he did. I mean, if I could either run it through, if it was even a Google Hangout or one of the YouTube live events. I was thinking Hangouts because it has the add-ons,
iPhone audio, doesn't that turn pretty good if you do it properly and there's not lots of background noise and all that?
It is, but you still need to run it through. But I was thinking the Hangout apps, because if I could just turn on an Audiophonic app on the Hangout
and record get the audio hangout, like watched.
That would be another way, so you wouldn't have to try and extract it afterward.
Mm-hmm.
You'd get it live, and then I'd get the Audiophonic email. I'm sorry, Greg. Like I said, it's excitement in this, and that's why you wanted me on, because I love playing with the audio. I love having the audio, and we're always looking. And I know us podcasters are looking to get that Google Hangout to MP3.
Yeah. You
know, I have actually no problem grabbing the MP3s afterwards. I use whatever, what is it called? I guess there are tons of services like that. But actually, it's I'm using this Windows program, whatever free YouTube MP3 converter, whatnot. And it does the job, no problem. But I got to do it, and it takes like 15 minutes to download the file, another 15 minutes to convert that, even though it's one seamless process. But anyway, and then it takes another 15 minutes to see to it that it's available on the web. So I mean, it's kind of a drag, and it never turns out as good as it could be. In case Georg, your weird algorithms would be involved somehow.
Yeah, well, I'm looking to grab it right at the beginning.
What do you say, Bjorn?
I said I'm the audio guy, so I know I want the purest audio. I don't want YouTube's processing on top of it.
Yeah, I understand.
So if I pull it, if I can go a live version of Auphonic into a Hangout, that means you get we get our Hangout, and then what I'll do after it, if I want the better audio on the YouTube, I would upload the Auphonic video to YouTube manually and replace the audio that way. And that would probably.
But I mean, YouTube audio, I don't think YouTube audio is a problem. If someone really watches the video, if the person can hear what's being said, it's kind of okay. But if you are just listening, it's got to be pretty good. It's got to be pretty good. Otherwise, you just don't want to listen to it, I think.
Yeah, I think one other problem is that although if you have such an MP3 converter from YouTube videos, if anyone else is doing it, it is illegal. So if you just do it automatically and put it on your server, the MP3 and also the video, for example, then everyone can download it legally and it's much more convenient.
But
actually,
right. But it shouldn't be illegal if I convert my YouTube video to MP3, right?
Of course.
Yeah, but that's the caveat with all those pieces of software.
Yeah.
They can get away with selling it because they say, you can only do this to your content.
right. Yeah.
And they don't tend to last very long.
They don't. That's right. Yeah, sure. Really interesting stuff. Oh, man.
Yeah, maybe I should make some things clear because you already had so many new ideas.
Crazy ideas.
No, good ideas. So, of course, if someone else wants to build such app, that's all possible because of our API. So, everything can be done with our API. So, if someone wants to build a Hangout plugin, I don't know if this is possible, but if it is possible, you can just use our API by JavaScript and do everything automatically.
Heavens. There must be someone out there listening who can pull it off and is interested in doing that. Do you think, Georg, it would be possible doing this in real time, like a plug for some kind of Hangouts or whatever?
Yeah, of course, you can do it also in real time, but you would have to change the algorithms a little bit because it's a little bit a different concept.
And it is, yeah.
So far, we focused on the non-real-time concept because nobody else is doing it.
Right.
Because I think this is also because of historical reasons, because most of the audio software is built for plugins, like VSD plugins or audio unit plugins, and they always have the concept of real time, so you only see a small buffer of audio at one point in time, and then you have to browse it and give it away. And because of this, most of the audio software, of course, works real time, also because of the history in the analog days. And nobody does this non-real time stuff and analyzes the whole audio file, so this was interesting for us to do this.
Yeah,
but I think you can at least record in real time up to Audiophonics. I mean, you already can do that with a web app. And then, I mean, Niilo, just think about turning on the Hangout app that somebody with even more knowledge than me and more time than me has. and a half an hour, an hour later after your podcast, after your Hangout is done, we have this beautiful audio, high-quality audio file emailed to us. Mm-hmm. I mean, that is just an ideal situation.
That would be an ideal situation. Absolutely.
Of course, this should be perfectly possible. And as always, it's just a matter of available time.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. Well, we got to get you another big grant.
Yeah, let's see to it that someone with some financial muscles and interest learns about this stuff.
So we're gonna get the word out.
We'll get the word out, for heaven's sake. Absolutely.
Yeah, we want to get Greg paid.
another thing, since we are in a Hangout and talking about Hangouts as well, and the audio stuff going on here, another thing that's really really hard to figure out, at least the way I see it, using Hangouts is that I never know what the final audio mix will sound. There's no way. Well, there's one exception. If I have some kind of a producer who is monitoring this stuff through YouTube on my live feed and tells me, "Hey, now we got to do this and that. The mix is not good. We got to change it." Okay, then that's actually the only way to do anything about the final mix, if you like, going into the YouTube recording, and that's kind of frustrating. I have no idea what's going to stick, you know.
Yeah, I think that's not the focus of Hangout, that you have the perfect audio mixing console and can monitor everything.
I'm not actually talking about getting a perfect result. Sometimes yeah. I just have noticed that it's a crappy result. I mean, really, really bad. I know nothing about this stuff, and I'm not a gearhead like Bjorn, but I hear when the result is really bad, and especially if it's so bad, you know, like the levels might be so much off that it's really, you know, pain listening to it. And sometimes I've noticed there was no way for me to figure that out during the broadcast.
Yeah, that's difficult. I also did an interview yesterday, and afterwards I noticed that my microphone always were very quiet and very loud. Mm-hmm. So it was not consistent, but during the recording I just didn't hear it. So
it's impossible. And I think, like, you know, this stuff, Hangouts, the only way to fix it is to have someone monitoring the live YouTube feed.
Actually, Niilo, that's one of the reasons why I'm trying to get you to switch the mic.
It doesn't matter what I do with. I have a new mic, by the way. Don't I sound great?
You need it. Do you have one? Yeah, it sounds great. You have one that has a monitor port?
Actually, yeah, even though that one is not plugged in now. But Bjorn, what the heck does it matter if I have a monitor port in my microphone? It doesn't change the fact that I have no idea what is being recorded, what kind of audio is being recorded on YouTube.
Well, that's what the monitor port is. And that's also one of the things.
It's not a that monitor feed is not coming from YouTube. It's coming from my microphone, for heaven's sake.
Well, you want to hear yourself. Well, and that's also one of the reasons why
I might sound just fine when I hear myself, but it does not mean that I sound good when someone is listening to me on YouTube.
Sound good today.
Well, yeah, I sound good today. I know that. It's a ticky mic. I can give those guys kudos here. It's a ticky. What is it? Blue? Is it a blue ticky mic? Even though there's something weird going on with this mic, since I cannot adjust the audio level, the audio that goes into my computer somehow. I've tried Macs and PCs, whatever, and it might be something wrong with the microphone. I can't adjust it in the computer. Really strange. But I guess it's okay anyway, so what the heck.
It sounds good.
Yeah. All right. Good enough. Whoa. I got carried away here a bit, I think.
I think we both did. Like I said, the excitement that we're getting out of this is really cool, because that is one of the hardest things. I ran a student podcast last year, and they used my equipment. They had, you know, a $300 mixer. They had really nice Audio Technica microphones.
Oh, God.
And it was cool, because they were all in the same room. First problem I had is I had to actually throw another compressor on it just so I could limit each person talking, because there was so much bleed through, which is something I'm really hoping with the multiple...
All this mumbo-jumbo compressors and bleed
people
through
come,
and stuff.
You being
oh,
able
give
to
me a break.
Exactly. But this is maybe I can just tell a little bit about this, because this is also a point in the multi-channel version.
Yeah, that's where
you have always this... I don't know the English word for it, but in German it's called Übersprechen. So if you record one channel, it's also somehow recorded in the next channel.
Oh, crosstalk or something like
crosstalk,
that?
Crosstalk, exactly, crosstalk.
Uh-huh. And, did you notice that, Bjorn? Did you notice? I'm in the game.
I have like $300 worth of equipment to try and stop that, because we're in a
exactly, room. but if you do it not live and afterwards, you can really analyze the audio and see, okay, where is now the speaker and where it's just crosstalk. And if you know this, you can of course much better remove this crosstalk.
Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
I mean, I spend, Niilo, I really spend a lot of time looking at my audio because I record everything
I
separately.
I know that. I know
but
you spend lots
I have
of
to,
time looking
there's
at
times
your
where
audio.
I can see I'm looking at the wave and I can see where there is crosstalk because my limiter didn't cut me out enough. And then I have to go through and erase it all or else I get the echo. So I'm,
and it just takes like 4 or 5 hours getting that done, huh?
Yeah. No, it but what happened with all this really high-end equipment I get, we get this nice quality sounding podcast. Nobody, none of the students took over the audio processing part of it. They did a lot of great stuff.
Were they not interested or was it too hard or what?
It was both.
Too much work.
Someone had to learn how to do it, and it's not like everybody in the class can learn how to audio process. It's not easy to look at waves and be able to be meticulous about making things sound good. And ultimately, I had to scrap all of my equipment and just put an iPad in the middle of the room.
Yeah.
And so the audio quality just went down considerably, which kind of, you know, for me, it was annoying, but the content, you know, at least stayed well, and it got produced, where before I had to stay there and be the audio person. So something like Audiophonic is going to be a huge advantage in that realm.
Yeah, of course, because, I mean, the content producers should not have to be audio professionals to produce their content. And, of course, it's not interesting for them if they are no audio geeks. And, yeah, it should just,
right.
It should just be a button to process, and that's it.
Yep.
Okay.
I mean, my reality is, you know, that's what you're talking about, Georg, my situation, and I'd say 99 out of 100 teachers, that there is no way to put lots of time and effort into polishing the audio. No way. It's quick and dirty, and it remains dirty if there is no automatic way of fixing it, like what you guys are doing. That's the only way of fixing it, the way I see it. Yeah, interesting for sure. So what kind of plans do you guys have now? Do you have any Georg, any connections or any promising whatever?
Yeah, at the moment we just released last week our desktop version for our leveler. So
okay.
this is for now it's a Mac program. The Windows version is still in development, where you can use the Auphonic leveler also on your desktop computer.
So it's all the same processing power in the program that anybody can use.
Yes, it's not everything yet, which is on our web service. So on the web service, you have all the encoding things and metadata management and YouTube publishing and everything. Mm-hmm. So that's not in the standalone program. It's just about the audio algorithms.
Yeah, signal processing.
And we are also, as I said, we are just building the Windows version also. And yeah, after this, if this is finished, so by the way, this is not a free program, it is a paid program because we have to get some money in at the moment.
Absolutely. What's the cost?
And it's $69 for this is the discounted license. Then there is also a professional license for big companies, which is a little bit more expensive. I don't remember it now.
And the educational license? Come on.
You can choose. And what did I want to say? Yeah, afterwards, after this standalone program, we will continue to work on the multi-channel version. So this will be the next big thing, which will first appear in the web service. So hopefully soon. And yeah, then we will see what we will do next.
Do you think you have the possibility to keep the web service free?
Not totally free, as I said before. So we will do this freemium model.
Mm-hmm.
So we didn't fix the numbers yet. How much is free and how much should be paid? But
yeah. Perhaps you could do, you know, like a couple of files every month free or something like that.
Exactly.
At least in education, huh?
Of course.
I'm looking at. I mean, many of even a lot of the programs that you pay for in the audio world, you pay for the plugins that get added in.
Yeah.
So I'm thinking that, you know, you very base service, and then, you know,
you pay a little bit
more to get the different plugins.
That's complicated. I mean, of course, you would want to give. I mean, the ideal thing would be, of course, to have everything for free, so everyone can use it.
Well, yeah. No, I'm looking for.
Yeah, but the thing is, you want to use it also if you. So our philosophy is that the best thing is maybe to make it to restrict it by length.
Mm-hmm.
So I mean, if you have 300 hours of audio every day, then you can maybe afford to pay for it a little bit.
Maybe, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And yeah, so you can use everything also as a free user.
Mm. I'm not expecting to get all this stuff for free, really, and that would be a crazy thing to expect. Of course, you guys got to make both ends meet, and hopefully there will be a penny for you after that as well. I mean, this sounds so darn great, the whole thing, that I have lots of contacts in the education field in the European Union, and there's lots of things happening with audio and video, and accordingly, I think there will be a great need for this, you know, like one-stop solution for audio recordings, and I will definitely spread the word all that I can, you know, about this, since it would be a great thing for many people involved in audio production.
Yeah, universities are of course a big target for us. So if you have some connections or some research projects or whatever, we are of course very interested.
Mm.
So also here in Graz, we have this cooperation with the university, and that's quite nice.
Yeah. Are you guys, all of you guys working with Auphonic, are you from Graz University? You've been studying there?
Yes. I mean, they are not studying anymore there, but we
They've
are all...
been there.
Yes, we. Mm-hmm. I think we all studied here, yes.
Yeah, all right.
Mm-hmm. Now, have you been interviewed by Ray Ortega and... that crew yet?
Nope. You must get in there.
Oh, okay, we're going to get you on because that will take your. It's Ray. Which one's Ray's?
Podcasters Roundtable. That's
he's
that's,
got the Podcasters Roundtable.
Yeah, he's the host there with Daniel. What is his name? Daniel.
Dan.
Shoot.
Oh my goodness!
It doesn't matter. We'll get the name straight. But really, I think they. It would surprise me if they wouldn't like to talk to you, honest.
And yeah, those guys haven't got to you yet. I can't believe we got to you first.
Yep, and those guys are, like I said, Georg, those guys are all pros. You know, they are doing it. Most of them are, I think, do it for a living. Strangely enough, there are people who make a living in podcasting or consulting or whatever. And this should be right up their alley, I think. Absolutely.
That would be great. So up till now, so we are more present in the German podcasting scene.
Mm.
So yeah, we had lots of interviews, and we are really in a great discussion with all of them and build lots of new ideas. As I already said, with this BotLove project, which also comes from there, but not so much in the US scene so far.
Well, I'm going to be posting it on.
Let's change.
Yeah, well, I'm.
This would be great.
Yeah, this is actually Niilo. This is going to be can I label this as a Ed Listen one too?
Oh, go ahead. Be my guest. Be my guest.
So we're going to grab the audio. You're going to process it through Audiophonic, and then you're going to send me the link to the MP3 file, and I'll make sure I post that on my Lipson stream, so it goes out on there. So you'll at least be a podcast in US.
Yep. Well, we'll see to it. You get at least decent audio somehow.
You're going to send me the Audiophonic file, just the link once you process it.
Okay. It would be kind of interesting actually to compare. I don't know, like this scenario, what we've been talking now. Actually, I think the audio is decent. You know, I haven't had anyone running in here or there hasn't been this. You know, behind my back. There's actually a kitchen, I'm at work. I always do this stuff at work. And behind my back, there's this kitchen where senior citizens have these gatherings for, they have whatnot, food and cookies and stuff, and they have this pro-grade dishwasher there. And I'm telling you, when that thing gets started, then there would be some use for Auphonic magic. I'm telling you, the whole place is shaking when that dishwasher gets started. Luckily, yeah, they are not here now. So I don't think that Auphonic processing would make a huge difference to this audio. We'll see. That'll be interesting to see, actually.
Yeah, I think the bigger problem here in this recording is, we are doing this on Google Hangouts, so all our audio is already compressed.
Absolutely. It's crappy already. It's been ruined already.
Lossy encoding, and yeah, we can unfortunately not redo this compressing of the audio.
Of course, I could have skipped the Hangouts encoding if I'd used the whatever it's called, the Bjorn, help. What is it called?
I know what you're talking about. It only lasts 10 minutes.
The music mode, whatever, for people who run live music through Hangouts.
Well, this is why I'm really looking forward to a Hangout app, because if it could be tech, and especially with the multi-processing. So if, Niilo, you turned on, if I just enabled this Hangout app, I'm wondering if it could be enabled on your end and my end, both of them kind of recorded straight to Auphonic, and then Auphonic processes that, and it produces one MP3. I mean, that would give me my straight-up live recording, your straight-up live recording.
Yeah, that would bypass everything. That would be as good as it could possibly get.
Yeah, I mean, that's our podcaster's dream.
Right. But that's crazy. I mean, to me, it really doesn't matter. talking about the Hangouts audio quality, I mean, it's now when I have my beautiful new microphone, everything. Actually, that's fine with me.
It's always a question of how much work you have to put into it afterwards.
Absolutely.
Yeah, no, I'm looking at this.
If everything is done automatically, then it's of course nice.
Yeah, it is.
And we're always trying to skip the going through Skype or trying to skip through going through Hangouts. And that's why that other piece of software Ray was so excited about, because he could record the double ender.
Yeah, it was doing just that. It was doing what you were talking about.
And I'm looking at the Auphonic here, and I don't see why that wouldn't be too many steps to turn that into being able to record the double ender, especially with the multi-processing he's putting in there. And then you add in all the other great filters and stuff that he's putting in.
Yeah.
That will take using Google Hangouts as a means of doing high-quality audio podcasts next level.
Extremely, extremely high-quality audio podcasts. And I think if that would that app would be possible to put, put together, I think there would be quite a few people who'd be willing to pay for it.
Yeah, I mean, I would pay for it if I could do that, and would make it so that my interviewee doesn't even need to know that they're turning it on.
Yeah.
I just turn it on. Their audio is being recorded straight from their end.
Yeah.
My audio is being recorded straight from my end. Mm-hmm. And then Auphonic can take that and individually process them and merge them.
Mm-hmm.
Because the audio files, and Greg, you definitely would understand this, the audio processing that it would take on Niilo, who's in Sweden, and me, who happens to be in Vermont, USA, are completely different types of audio processing and what we have to take away. And the last thing you want to do is munch those together and then have to process it.
Mm-hmm.
So
yeah, it just gets worse and worse.
But yeah, this
by a factor of I don't know what.
That's exactly why we are working on these algorithms.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, right.
They'll definitely keep me in the loop.
By the way, about the stuff I've been doing, recording my students' discussions here. I was doing it with my smartphone, as I said, and I had this elaborate setup so that, how the heck was I doing it? I recorded my smartphone, and then the files were automatically uploaded to Dropbox through this whatever syncing app I have, and then I connected the Auphonic account to Dropbox, and I could just take them from there and batch process them all together. And then I, when they were done, which happens amazingly quickly, I must say that, when they were done, I downloaded the works back to a Dropbox folder, which was automatically synced with my phone, so I had them back in my phone, you know, polished and done. But there were quite a few steps there anyway. So just imagine that anyone could just grab his phone, record the students, and you don't need to do anything. You have this syncing app, whatever, and it uploads the stuff to the cloud, and from there, the Auphonic magic that starts, you know, and it does its thing, and bang, you got the stuff back, you know.
Yes, well, I think the mobile app does that already, doesn't it?
Exactly, but what you were saying, we also had this idea already that you can have multiple phones, and for example, like we do now our interview on three different locations, and everyone has his phone and records in his phone, and then all gets streamed to the Auphonic servers, and there they are mixed together afterwards. So
now it's getting crazy.
No, but
it's getting crazy.
No, this is not crazy. This is exciting because we just took out the middleman that we're all trying to get around. I mean, I know a lot of podcasters who just still stick with Skype. Mm-hmm. And what they do is they'll put multiple audio cards inside their computer so they can run multiple versions of Skype so everybody
See what Twit is doing, you know, like Laporte and their crew. Basically, it's that setup, isn't it?
That's exactly. I mean, they can't move to Hangouts because they can't separate out the different audio feeds.
No. Yeah.
Yeah, here that's where... In Germany, many people are using Mumble. I don't know if you know this. It's like Skype, so it's an audio-only chat, I think. Don't know if
what do you
video.
Say it's called one more time?
Mumble. I will also write
Never
it
heard.
In the chat.
Never heard.
It's like Skype, but open source, and you can customize it and record on all ends, and you can everything. You can do everything there, but it's without video, I think.
Hmm. Yeah, but I'm looking at this as... just a quick little add-on, and yeah, this is that will take that whole concept of having multiple sound cards and multiple Skype things all coming in and just kind of blow that out of the water.
Yeah, it iron out all the possible errors and all the garbage in that chain.
It takes it out. It gets the most cleanest audio coming in. It's not pre-processed, which is what we don't like. You know, as audio guys, really don't like that pre-processing that gets done.
By the way, it was really difficult to switch off all pre-processing on the iPhone.
I guess, yeah. By the way, talking about processing still, even this. It's called studio mode in Hangouts, by the way. Studio mode. Even if you use studio mode, there is still some algorithms at work, processing at work, I think. But and it's optimized for music. I tried that for speech, and it was no good at all in my view.
Yes, I can imagine.
It's not a clean signal in any way, I think.
Mm. No, and like I said, I like recording everything separately. My biggest problem right now that I have is when I have, it's okay if I have three people right now in my studio because I have a mic sitting next to me, my mic, and I run it through a limiter to break it off so both of us aren't, or a gate, so neither one of us are talking over each other. We don't get the bleed through. Hmm. And then I have my one guest. But if I have more than one guest in my Google Hangout, those two guests are now merged into one audio file, even for my own processing.
Yeah.
And a lot of times one's really quiet and one's really loud, and I can't fix that. If I could get them in, if I can get them to record it, the double ender from their end, controlled by me,
Interesting stuff, really interesting stuff. Man, we've been going like, I don't know how long, way longer than planned. I think you promised us 1 hour, Georg, so we're doing overtime here, and I guess, I don't know about you guys, I want to go home. my working week is done, Bjorn. Can you understand that? My working week is done.
Your working week is it's 10:15 here. I got to go downstairs and clean. I got my daughter's on vacation this week.
Well, cleaning at home, sure, I got to do that as well. But my wife, I think she'll soon be wondering what's happened, you know, like, where are you? I want to get out of here. I want to get home, get some dinner as well.
But, Niilo, you are in the same time zone than me? I guess so.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, right. That's correct. Okay. That's correct. We are in good shape. Bjorn, the poor man, he has still got the whole day. What are you doing? Are you working today, Bjorn?
No, it's a school vacation. So
I'm right. With That's my daughter. Right. That's right. You just cleaned the house.
Clean the house. I got to build some railings, even though it's really snowy, wet, and rainy. And
We have nice winter weather here. What about Austria right now?
It's actually quite summer already.
What? Oh man, that's cheating.
The sun is shining.
Oh man, I was driving on black ice this morning trying to drop my daughter off. I go stop at an intersection. Huh? I'm like honking my horn because my car wasn't stopping.
Oops. We have spikes. Bjorn, spikes.
Spikes.
Yep. Listen, guys, this has been really, really interesting, even for a non-tech person like me. I think I got something. I got the main idea, I think, and it's truly fascinating. And like I said, normally, because I don't have time for any post work of any kind. I don't do anything, no notes, nothing, show notes, that doesn't exist for me. But now there's got to be something, because so many interesting things popped up here, and especially from you, Georg. So
Georg, if you can come up with the show notes solution too, you're...
Actually, you are laughing now, but within this Botlove project I mentioned, they have also a show notes team, where they have a collaborative Etherpad, and they are all listening to the podcast live, and all people write the show notes live during listening the podcast.
Oh, God.
And everything gets synced automatically with the audio, so you can click on the thing they said and listen it in the podcast afterwards. So it's quite great.
Amazing.
Oh man.
Amazing stuff. We'll Georg, you know what? We'll definitely be in touch. I can promise that much.
This would be great.
And Bjorn, I think Bjorn will be in touch with Ray Ortega and the Podcasters Roundtable.
Once we post this thing out, we'll put it up on the Google Plus.
I've been chatting with him a little bit too. He's a really nice guy and very responsive. I must say that. He seems to be reasonably busy as well, but he responds amazingly quickly, and that's kind of neat. And I bet he's interested in this. So I think you'll hear from those guys on the other side of the pond, Georg.
Yeah, thanks for your invitation and for the great comments. So if you have some new ideas, then you can just send it to me.
We'll send all great crazy ideas your way. I promise you that.
No, but we'll get you on a round table, and those guys will interview the living out of you. I know this.
Yep.
And to the point where you might be a regular.
Might happen.
I could see it. Just like I said, my excitement, because I'm really into the audio end of things, just is beyond the possibilities is there. And just absolutely excited.
Yep. I'm kind of excited, like I said, as well, even though I'm not as crazy as you are, Bjorn. So, and thanks, Georg, a lot. It's been a blast. And thanks to you, Bjorn. You did contribute quite a bit here, I must say that. Amazingly enough.
Hey, I should take that one.
So I'm really glad that you could join us here. It was short notice, but sometimes things turn out the best on short notice. I've noticed that. It's kind of strange, but that's the way it works.
Well, I'm going to let you end the show, but since I'm going to post this on EdListen, I got to put my ending tag in.
So. Oh, man. I just got to tell you guys, see you on air. And what are you going to say, Bjorn?
You don't know this by now? Thank you very much, and never stop learning.
Whoa, there we have it. Georg, any famous last words from you before we
quit? Listen and see you again.
That's good enough. That's good enough. Take good care, everyone, and see you later.
Bye.
Bye-bye.